guests here today. I'm glad that you are here, and hopefully everything you need is either in this worship folder or in the Red Book. So there will be announcements a little bit later. And right now, I would invite you to stand as you are able and open your bulletin to page 2, to the confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the only sovereign who dwells in light, Christ Jesus who came to save sinners, the Holy Spirit who lives within us.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. God of overflowing grace, we come to you with repentant hearts.
Forgive us our shallow thankfulness. Forgive us as passing by the ones in need. Forgive us for setting our hopes on the needy treasures. Forgive us our neglected thoughtlessness. Bring us home from the wilderness of sin and strengthen us to serve you in all we do and say. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
There is joy in heaven over every sinner who repents. By the grace of God in Christ Jesus, who gave himself up for us all, our sins are forgiven and we are made free. Rejoice with the angels and with one another. We are home in God's mercy, now and forever.
Amen.
Our gathering song is number 836. Joyful, joyful, we adore you.
Thank you.
may love our neighbors and serve them for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
You may be seated. A few announcements. First of all, we were delighted that yesterday, last evening, we were able to celebrate the marriage of Alex and Tori Sims. It was a wonderful event, and that would be Jeanette's grandson. So that was a marvelous, marvelous occasion. Next, Senior Friends is meeting this coming Tuesday at 10:30. And Carolyn, do you want to say anything more about that?
We're going to go out to eat. It's
okay. Going to go out to eat after the meeting. And this afternoon, or right after church, we have an event, right? Women's event?
Yeah, the welcome is meeting.
The welcome service, okay. So everybody's invited to stay for that if you would like. Church Council is meeting next Sunday after church. And let's see. I don't think there's anything else coming up this week in particular. We also yesterday had our animal blessing in honor of the feast of St. Francis, who was a person who loved animals and who was able to communicate with them quite well. And we had several dogs come, and they were all dutifully blessed. And I understand from St. Timothy that the blessing that that one received did nothing with regard to behavior. So my reply was, "Even dogs sin." Any other announcements or things to share? Okay. I invite you then to prepare your minds and your hearts as we listen to God's word.
First reading comes to us from Habakkuk, the first and second chapter. The oracle that the prophet Habakkuk saw. O Lord, how long shall I cry for help, and you will not listen? Or cry to you violence, and you will not save? Why do you make me see wrongdoing and look at trouble? Destruction and violence are before me. Strife and contention arise. So the law becomes slack and justice never prevails. The wicked surround the righteous, therefore judgment comes forth perverted. I will stand at my watchpost and station myself at the rampart. I will keep watch to see what he will say to me and what he will answer concerning my complaint. Then the Lord answered me and said, write the vision. Make it plain on tablets, so that a runner may read it. For there is still a vision for the appointed time. It speaks of the end and does not lie. If it seems to tarry, wait for it. It will surely come. It will not delay. Look at the proud. Their spirit is not right in them, but the righteous live by their faith. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
The second reading is a reading from the first chapter of the book of 2 Timothy. This is a message written from Paul to Timothy. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God for the sake of the promise of life that is in Christ Jesus. To Timothy, my beloved child, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. I am grateful to God, whom I worship with a clear conscience, as my ancestors did, when I remember you constantly in my prayers, night and day. Recalling your tears, I long to see you so that I may be filled with joy. I am reminded of your sincere faith, a faith that lived first in your grandmother, Lois, and in your mother, Eunice, and now I am sure lives in you. For this reason, I remind you to rekindle the gift of God that is written you through the laying on of my hands. For God did not give us a spirit of cowardice, but rather a spirit of power and of love and of self-discipline. Do not be ashamed then if the testimony about our Lord or of me, his prisoner, but join with me in suffering for the gospel, relying on the power of God who saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace. This grace was given to us in Christ Jesus before the ages began, but it has now been revealed through the appearing of our Savior, Christ Jesus, who abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. For this gospel I was appointed a herald and an apostle and a teacher, and for this reason I suffer as I do. But I am not ashamed, for I know the one in whom I have put my trust, and I am sure that he is able to guard until that day what I have entrusted to him. Hold to the standard of sound teaching that you have heard from me in the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. Guard the good treasure entrusted to you with the help of the Holy Spirit living in us. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Somebody
does something to me, I'm supposed to forgive them that many times, even if they continue to do this? And so the disciples, the apostles, go to Jesus and say, give us more faith, because we don't have enough faith to do that. And Jesus responds by giving them two little parables almost. The first one, if you had faith the size of a mustard seed, you could say to this mulberry tree, be uprooted and go jump in a lake. Now, something just an aside, the mustard seed that Jesus was talking about is not the mustard seed that we know, the nice little round mustard seed that you can kind of hold in your hand. The mustard seed that belonged to that mustard tree that Jesus talked about in a different spot, the tree was about the size of a crepe myrtle. Okay, so that's how big that mustard tree grew. And the seed of that tree is about the size of the pepper that you would shake in your hand, a grain of pepper. So it's much, much, much smaller than that nice round yellow mustard seed. And Jesus said, if you had that much faith, you could do this marvelous thing. Wow. And you know, anybody would just have to say, well, I don't have that much faith because I'm not able to do that. And then Jesus tells a parable about a person, a landowner who has a slave, and the slave goes out and works in the field all day. And Jesus says, what do you expect this slave to do when he comes back to the house? Because he is a slave, a servant, you expect him to serve you. And not to have their own dinner until you have had yours. And Jesus says, likewise, you all, you are to do the work that is before you as my disciples. And when you're done with it, you're not supposed to say, hey, look at me, I've done it all. But you're just supposed to say, Lord, we just did what we were supposed to do. Excuse me. I don't know about you, but sometimes my faith isn't as strong as I would like it to be. Anybody ever have a doubt or two? I suspect that if we're honest with ourselves, we can all say that we have wondered, we have doubted, and sometimes those doubts get pretty big, and we want to say, God, are you there? That was a little bit of the experience of the disciples. That's why they wanted more faith. Well, there's a funny thing about faith. It's not really something that you can go to the store and buy. It's not something that comes in a bottle and you can drink. Or like a bar of soap, you can wash with it and you get more of it. Faith isn't like that. Faith is there as a gift from God. And whether we feel it or not, when we were baptized in the water of baptism, God claimed us as one of God's beloved children. That started our faith. Perhaps it was nurtured in Sunday school and in church and by our families. And even yet, sometimes, with all of that nurturing, we have doubts. Because we look at the world around us, and we think things like, or we even say things like, if God really were in existence, if God were really God, then X, Y, or Z would not be happening. If our job. We do our job as disciples of Jesus, and we put one foot ahead of the other, and we keep on walking the walk, and we keep on even pretending, as it were, that we have faith, because we really do. It's just that sometimes it feels so tiny to be non-existent. It would be so much easier, I suspect you would agree, if Jesus would come walking through the door and say, "Hi, y'all, I'm here. Come and follow me." And then Jesus would take us to shelters. He might take us to where the homeless people are living in town. He might take us to places we've never been, and we would see things that we've never seen. The disciples had that advantage. They could see Jesus. You and I get to walk by faith and not by sight. We don't hear Jesus talking to us and speaking to us in person and teaching us the parables and the Beatitudes and all of the other wonderful things in Scripture. But we still hear them. We still read them. And that little flicker of faith, no matter how small, as we continue to do the work, well, before long, you look back and you realize, gee, I must have had some faith to have done that. And Jesus did respond to my work and my life. And Jesus really did help me through whatever it was. This morning, I have little pieces of paper, and they all have sayings on them about faith. And so I'm going to pass these around. They're all different. And then I'm going to ask you to pair up with one other person and read your statement to them, and they read it to you, your theirs to you, and then talk for just 2 or 3 minutes about what that particular quote says to you or means to you, or if you're just puzzled by it, say that too, and maybe the other person can help you understand. So, it's kind of like getting a fortune cookie. So you have to look around and pair off. So, and if there's an extra person, then that extra person gets me. I've not counted to see if we have an odd or even number this morning.
We have 30.
We have 30?
I think.
Is that with or without me?
With you.
Okay. So there will be an odd number without me.
You're the odd one.
Yeah, I'm the
only one. Oh, I recorded that.
That's okay.
Okay, Lisa.
Faith is a living, daring confidence in God's grace, so sure and certain that a man could stake his life on 1,000 times. Martin Luther.
Or Martin Luther, the disciples. Mine says, faith is an oasis in the heart, which will never be reached by a caravan of skin.
What's your
faith? Good question.
So sure that a man is taking a while.
faith is an oasis in the heart which will never be reached by caravan thinking.
I don't think we're smart enough for this, are we?
We're confused on ours, baby.
Oh, that's right. I should have run up there and sat beside a yell.
Yeah, we need Harry's explanation.
You see, you're smarter than all of us.
Yeah, Carolyn's sitting next to Doris.
I
for the church, the world, and all those in need.
Increase the faith of your church, O God. Raise up faithful parents and grandparents, prophets and teachers who know, love, and spread your gospel. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Tend and nurture the lands and seas, O God. Raise up faithful stewards of all you have entrusted to human care. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Save the nations, O God. Raise up faithful leaders who will strive for peace and justice in the midst of violence and destruction. Especially we pray for our people in service, at home and abroad, especially Dolly Kugler, Jeremy Hefner, Annalisa Hernandez, Jason Honeycutt, Michael Mateus, Andrew Phelan, Angela Martinez, and Michael Smeebog. Hear us, O God. Guard those in need, O God. Raise up faithful advocates and caretakers for those who are oppressed, poor, lonely, imprisoned, bereaved, or sick, and especially for Fred LaFone, Carol Sims, Tom Wilson, Dick Eisenhower, Betty Eisenhower, Dot Eisenhower, Mary and Wayne Mason, Merle and Faye Martin, Thelma Miller, Betty Abernathy, Alja Moody, Linda Almond, Thelma Eichert, Agnes Pruitt, Gail Sigmund, Paul and Linda Eisenhower, Kelly Ross, Pete Ross, Chuck Bollinger, Randall Childers, Dot and Linda Bumgarner, Arishay Dunbar, Bob Meyer, Bud Riley, Willa Boston, Shirley Ramsor, Angie Hodge, Richard DeAndrea, Millie Kelly, Carolyn Sigmund, Ellen Wilson, Nancy Powell, Rita Busby, Andy Sigmund, Aline Jarrett, John Discus, Rayford Deal, and Nancy Sigmund. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Give vision to Faith Congregation, O God. Raise up faithful teachers, staff, volunteers, worship leaders, council members who serve with purpose, joy, boldness, and love. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You abolish death, O God. Thank you for all those you called according to your purpose and who now rest in your light. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Gracious God, you sent your Son, Jesus Christ, into the world to reveal your love for all people. Enrich Alex and Tori Sims, married here yesterday, with every good gift that their life together may show forth your love. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Into your hands, O God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior.
Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Please take some time and share God's peace.
Thank you. Thank you.
his blood in bread and cup, make us the body of your Son.
Through him, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, with the Holy Spirit, in your holy church, both now and forever. Amen.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom and hear us as we pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth.
oneness.